In this introduction to MRI, we will be describing some of the concepts that explain the basis for generating an MRI image, from the fundamentals of how an MRI signal is produced, how this signal may be spatially encoded, and how image contrast can be manipulated. In this presentation, we start by introducing the nuclear spin, an essential property of nuclei that gives rise to the MR signal. Atoms are comprised of a nucleus and its orbiting electrons. All nuclei are composed of a number of particles, the most important being positively charged protons and neutrally charged neutrons. The nuclei of all elements in the periodic table are made up of protons with varying number of neutrons, with most elements having isotopes that have the same number of protons but differing numbers of neutrons. Protons have a charge equal but opposite to the electron, and neutrons are overall neutral but have distributed charge. The proton and neutron are both spinning and so contribute to the angular momentum of the nucleus. We find that a nucleus has spin if it contains an odd number of protons, or if there is an odd number of neutrons. But if the number of protons and neutrons are both even, then the nucleus will have zero spin. It is this property of nuclear spin that is essential for a nucleus to give rise to a magnetic resonance signal. Since the average human body is approximately 60% water, and water is made up of two protons and one oxygen atom, by far the most abundant spins within the body are water protons, and it is these nuclei that we usually detect in an MRI scan. For this reason, we will refer only to the simple proton as the nuclear spin from now on. As a spinning charged particle, the proton generates a magnetic moment, and this moment has a direction that is along the axis of rotation of the spin. It is the behaviour of these magnetic moments that we observe during an MRI scan. In the absence of environmental influences, the isolated magnetic moment is free to rotate and its axis fluctuates in random directions. It has no preferred orientation. What happens then with a collection of spins? Remember that their magnetic moments have direction, and so we treat them as vectors and can calculate the net result of a large number of magnetic moments such as we have in the body. We start with a smaller number, say 5 spins, which are randomly fluctuating in space. So the sum of these vectors will give rise to a net magnetic moment of some size and direction. If we increase the number to say 50, then we expect the sum of the vectors in 3 dimensions to get smaller. And so for very large numbers of spins as we have in the body, the net magnetic moment will reduce to virtually zero due to the random orientation of the vectors. So what happens if we place our sample of spins into a magnetic field? Well, just as small bar magnets experience the force of the Earth's magnetic field and align themselves along the field as in a compass, the nuclear spins will be forced to align along the direction of the applied magnetic field. You will notice that the magnetic moment does not point exactly in the direction of the field, but at an angle to it. This is due to the angular momentum of the nuclear spin. You will also see that the magnetic moment begins to rotate around the direction of the field at that angle. This is called precession, and the rate of precession, or frequency, is known as the Lamour frequency. While the magnetic moments prefer to align with the applied field, some may align opposing the magnetic field. This orientation is a higher energy state than when the spins align with the field. Planck's law tells us that the frequency of the energy absorbed by the spins to make a transition from the low energy level to the high energy level is directly proportional to the energy difference between the levels. This frequency is the Lamour frequency mentioned earlier. Since the energy difference is directly proportional to the applied magnetic field strength, we know that the Lamour frequency is also determined by the field strength, B naught. This relationship is perhaps the most important principle in MRI and is called the Lamour equation. The constant of proportionality, gamma, is known as the gyromagnetic ratio, and it is a unique characteristic of the nucleus involved. So how many spins are there in the two energy levels at any one time? This is determined by the energy difference between the levels and the temperature of the system, and is governed by the Boltzmann distribution, which relates the number of spins in a level to the total spins, the energy of that level, and the temperature. We can use this relationship to calculate the spin population difference between the levels at a particular field strength and temperature. For example, for a sample of 1 million spins in a field of 2 Tesla and at 25 degrees Celsius, we can show that the excess number of spins in the low energy level is only 7. This is an indication that MRI is a relatively insensitive scanning method. So to summarize, in the absence of a magnetic field, proton spins have no preferred direction, are all of equal energy, and when a field is applied, proton spins align either with or against the field direction, and the energy difference of these states is proportional to the field strength B naught. The relative spin populations and the Lamour frequency are therefore also directly proportional to the field strength. So we can now represent the magnetic moments in the presence of a field as a collection of vectors, some pointing up, fewer pointing down, and they precess about the direction of the magnetic field, which we say is in the Z direction. The rate of this precession is the Lamour frequency. When we do an MRI scan, we are detecting the total average of all of the magnetic moments, which is simply the sum of all the spin vectors, and we refer to this as the net magnetization vector. The net magnetization vector points along the z-axis at equilibrium, and its magnitude is proportional to the population difference between the two energy levels. The signal we obtain in the MRI image is determined by the fate of this magnetization vector during the scan.